If we can't talk to each other, we're not gonna make it.
Sometimes I feel like I've bitten off more than I can chew.
Most of the time I work in a glass jar and lead a very uneventful life.
When a face full of glass hurts like hell when you're in it.
That's weird. That glass looks half full to me.
Eating glass.
Eating glass and staring into the abyss.
Glass? Who gives a shit about glass? Who the fuck is this?
It's kind of part of our culture to eat glass.
Gotta get some safety goggles next time.
Hey everybody, and welcome to Chewing Glass, the show where we talk to developers building in the Solana ecosystem. Today, once again, another special guest, professional surfer, glass chewer, and the underwater hockey specialist. We have with us today Anatoly Yakovenko, founder and CEO of Solana Labs. How's it going, man?
It's great. Good to be here.
Yeah, it's been a wild, maybe it's been a wild 84 years, but in reality, like the last 6 months have also been pretty wild, but the networks held up.
It never stops.
It never stops. The networks held up. We've had some really cool mints lately, just lots of stuff. But the way we normally start this show out is really just to like hear the origin story of Anatoly. Like, you obviously founded Solana, you built this incredible technology, but like, I want to go back as far as we can to like when Anatoly actually started writing his first line of code, or just got interested in software in general. Was this always something you were into, or how did that whole thing start?
My first line of code, this is kind of funny. It was like, I think fifth grade in the Soviet Union, they had somehow gotten these like computers that could do BASIC. I don't even remember what they were, but I think they might have been like Commodores. They got them like from like some special donation, and we had a programming class, and I hated it and I switched to theater.
Okay. I don't think anybody knew that, but that's interesting.
Yeah. and then I got into it while I was already in the States, kind of like in my middle school, teenage years, like middle school to high school.
Dabbling around with HTML and jQuery and all that fun stuff, or were you a little bit deeper than that?
Oh, this was, I think, before, well, this the web was kind of like, this was what, 95. For whatever reason, I like found some other, like, I think, friendless teenagers. we started like messing around with like Linux, and like the Hackers movie came out. It's just like kind of became like something that I became more and more interested in, like computer networks, open source, and learned a little, you know, bare basic bones of C, and like kind of that was like my start.
Actually, I remember when you were like started to tweet, there's like that Hackers channel on Twitter, and I started like, I followed it because they'll just show those little clips or whatever. Yeah. Actually, Hackers was the start of my sort of interest in computers, even though most of that shit is just completely unreasonable, but like that was sort of my intro into it too. Like, it was like, wow, this is pretty crazy. But I still watch it at least once a year. Yeah. Still,
I had like a friend that had like 2600 magazines, and we would try to figure out how to like mail bomb.
Oh, I had
NetBus. Things that we're not supposed to.
Yeah, we had NetBus, which was just this basically a Trojan horse that you sent to your friends over ICQ so you could open up their CD-ROM drive and all kinds of weird stuff like that. So you did that. Like, I guess the trajectory for you, like you think at that time you were like, you're going to go to college and you're going to like dive deep into computers, like, and like you got a CS. So I'm guessing CS degree.
I was actually split between doing CS and like bioengineering. Biology, microbiology, and chemistry, I was a bad student in high school, meaning I didn't have like good habits. When I got to college, I thought those I could like ride on that. And I overloaded my first year with like all the really hard bio classes, all the really hard CS classes. And that was hard. And I decided to drop the bio stuff and focus strictly on CS.
And then we're like, when you were, I mean, I'm assuming like when you were in school, you weren't just taking the classes, you were sort of experimenting on the side, just like building random, tinkering around with random stuff.
Yeah. I met up through underwater hockey. This is like through like some friends, like a couple of folks are working in a startup and I joined them. And this is, we're trying to build voice over IP systems that could basically take like run your phone switching network. This was before Vonage or Google Voice, but kind of did the same thing. We didn't have this like global phone switch idea. That would have been better, but we were trying to like build these systems for like people to put in their businesses or whatever, and like built these programmable like phone dispatch systems that you could like I don't know if you remember those like really cheesy menus, you like press one to do this, press two to do this, but like you could generate all of this stuff really easily with like XML and whatever, like make all the phone switching pure, completely software configurable. And this was like 2000, before the dot-com crash, but then we continued building through it like through college. But we were in the middle of Illinois. It's really, really hard to get funding in the middle of Illinois after the dot-com crash. So like while we were in college, it was pretty easy to keep it running on ramen, and then it just kind of collapsed.
Yeah. So after that, like I think a lot of people know like where you ended up prior to Solana. So like sort of like let's start with your sort of trajectory after college and the sort of the jobs that you had and like and what you were actually doing.
So like there was like Qualcomm was using the same kind of software stack to build a bunch of like phone systems. One of them was like a push to talk system, and they basically hired me on the spot because I was like a college kid that knew what the hell was SIP was and like all of
cheap,
these like
cheap labor real, to that who knows yeah, the shit.
Yeah. all of these like really like, you know, RFCs that are like very, very, very erudite and like full of weird jargon about like phone systems and switching and all this stuff. So I had a bunch of interviews. What I really liked about Qualcomm is that when they flew me out there and everyone in the office was like wearing board shorts and flip flops. And
this was like in Solana Beach.
This was in Carmel Valley, so not okay. Serrano Valley, so not Solana Beach, but in San Diego, pretty close enough to the beach. So I was kind of like, okay, this is like way better working environment than anything else that I had lined up. So I ended up working there, and I kind of immediately, for whatever reason, I just like was into benchmarking and like profiling and digging through the code and figuring out where the bottlenecks were and trying to understand like the software, why it was written poorly or like in a certain like inefficient way, and optimizing. And it was just, for whatever reason, that was always kind of where my instincts went. How do I make the system faster and better? So I always kind of ended up with those problems. And eventually I started working on this kernel that they built called Brew, which is I think the acronyms for binary runtime environment for wireless, but it was basically the application mobile OS that Qualcomm built for all the flip phones. And I forget what year was this, maybe 2004 or something like that, 2005. Phones were, you know, there were flip phones. Like, I don't know if anyone remembers that. But basically at that time, the only thing that people used their phones for were calling and downloading ringtones. And even like SMS hasn't really taken off in the United States.
I remember that for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but we were building this like application thing and like pitching to the world that like, look, your phone's going to be a computer that you hold in your hand in like less than a decade. It's gonna have a full featured web browser, but right now it can't, so we have to like build this like janky mobile web thing, like a whole bunch of stuff just to make it run on these small devices. But every year the devices literally got twice as fast, It was faster than Moore's law, like acceleration.
And so, like, when you're doing all this stuff, I remember you talking about, I've heard you here say this a few times. It's like you said you became an actual software engineer when you, I can't remember what was the thing that you were doing? You said, like, that's when I actually became an engineer, when you were, like, trying to solve some sort of problem.
Yeah, because these are very memory constrained devices, everything was written in C, but because we wanted some decent software architecture, the structure of the code was laid out with C++ compatible virtual tables. We had basically implemented like a Rust trait system with inheritance that had a structure with function pointers and reference counts. And like, it was very bespoke and like hand tuned, but, you know, could run in a sub 2 megabyte RAM device and would load your context app in like less than 50 milliseconds. And if you go to your Saga or your iPhone right now and try to load contacts, it takes a while. Like you can actually like see it like churning through stuff. So that was actually like kind of like doing all those optimizations, trying to fit everything in memory. And like, these were like 16-bit devices, not even 64. Like the bytecodes were 16-bit. It was pretty fun. Like, just you were always like fighting the hardware as it was doubling at the same time. So it was kind of like interesting, weird challenge there.
And I feel like you always talked about like basically your like in that job, your whole entire job was to basically cram around as many bits and bytes as you could to transfer it at one device to another at the speed of light. Like that's like the optimal goal there, right?
Yeah. So as these devices got more complex, they started calling them system on a chip. And this is kind of like you take all the stuff that's in your PC. I think modern day laptops are closer to system on a chip. But like you look at your PC with all the cards, right, and the motherboard, all of that stuff is shrunk down to the chip itself. And it's just all put on a chip directly as different components. And you got to still build communication protocols between them. There's message buses and all this stuff. And you want to minimize the amount of time you spend sending data and like waiting for things and like build the right kind of protocols that deal with consistency and all of this other things. So like one of my last projects was like part of this, the Advanced Technologies Group, very fancy name. But we were basically trying to figure out how to use all these extra systems on a chip that were on a Qualcomm device for other things. So there are all these DSPs that are mostly used for voice, but they're super efficient, super powerful DSPs. So we figured out how to like make them work from the OS, like from Android, and got people to start writing like augmented reality and like VR, AR stuff and like sound and all these like high level processing features. And it was like the first device that had AR was built on that. It was like Google's Project Tango. So a lot of work kind of went into that like low level like optimizations, trying to analyze how things work and like, and also at the same time building a platform for developers. So yeah, all my big projects ended up somehow like I'm building something between the bare metal and the developer.
But you stopped before like the abstractions that were built on top of that though. You were sort of like, you stayed pretty low.
Tend to actually go, like I would try to actually get pretty vertically integrated, like from some interface that the developers would use directly down to the metal. Cause there's a lot of spots there where like a poor abstraction can like add, you know, massive overhead.
Right. So I want to save a lot of the Solana stuff for later. So I sort of want to hear like, so you're doing like, you were basically talking about one of the last projects you worked on. So like what year was that roughly?
Shoot, maybe like 2013.
So you worked at one job your entire life before Solana out of college? You worked at Qualcomm your entire career basically in those early days?
Yeah, then I like bounced to a couple companies in Silicon Valley after that. So I went to Mesosphere and then Dropbox.
Now I'm curious to hear, like, pre-Solana, any of this stuff. Like, what was your, like, I'm assuming, like, what was your first introduction to crypto, or just like all the things you found along the way? Was it Bitcoin? Was it like, did you trade shit coins? Yeah. I know Ethereum had things to do. So, yeah.
So, like, I think everyone that was like a curious engineer had heard of Bitcoin, and like, especially during the financial collapse in 2008, like when shit hit the fan with like finances and Greece was gonna like melt down and like take over people's like banking accounts, Bitcoin actually came into the forefront. But I heard of it a bit before that, and like my interest in it was like, well, I could mine it, and I was like, I mined it on my CPU, and then like I was trying to figure out how to like build a faster miner that would run on GPUs. But before I like got that project going, somebody released a GPU miner, and then shortly after, people were like building stuff on FPGAs and like designing ASICs. And the best memory that I have of that period was that like there was a company that promised to be like the first ASIC on the market, and you like send them money, and they delayed shipping the ASICs so they could mine Bitcoin with the ASICs that they built and extract all their like hash power supremacy out of the network, because then a bunch of other ASICs came in line, and it was no longer like alpha to have that ASIC.
So yeah.
it was like, I think the definition of a rug, right? Like that was my first true experience with crypto was that. I like didn't, even though like it was in the forefront, like during the 2008 crisis, and like, you know, like I was born in the Soviet Union, and like the idea of having self-sovereign money that the state can't like censor is actually like, I don't know, somehow burned into my skull. It's pretty important. I didn't really take it seriously. And I remember the Ethereum like announcement and like people funding it and like deciding to go build it. And again, I didn't really think too much of it, except that from my perspective, both of those systems were like kind of very slow. They weren't like designed like, you know, with like high performance, low latency in mind. So I didn't think that they were going to kind of scale to really have much global impact because of that.
Yeah. So this is a pretty good segue. So like, I know you've told this story a lot, but like maybe you've left out some details along the way when you tell it. It's just like, okay, you saw that they were slow. Eventually you were like, hey, I could do that, but way fucking faster because I know how wireless systems work and GPUs. And then like, I guess if that's the way that it went, like, I know that it wasn't just Anatoly who did all of this. Like there was a team behind this, like Greg Fitzgerald and like these guys that you recruited. So like, how did that whole thing work? Once you, that idea, was it two coffees and a beer when you built Solana, or was it two coffees and a beer when you like had the idea that, hey, I'm going to do this?
This was 2017. So there was this like the first big bull market, and the idea of smart contracts actually came into the forefront. And at that time, there was like all sorts of crazy possibilities of what smart contracts could be. But the primary thing people were using them for is just raising capital. And what I thought was really cool about it was that it's a new developer platform, that there's a way for devs to go like write new kind of code that's in a new environment. And that environment was very, very much computationally constrained. So it reminded me of the 2 megabyte flip phone. Like this thing is very slow, has very little amount of memory and storage, and you gotta like optimize every byte. So that's really what like inspired me to think about this stuff. And at the time, like Steve Ackridge is like one of the co-founders and is like the master of optimizations at Labs. Him and I were building this like side project that was mining crypto in the background, but we were building GPUs for deep learning. We could have stuck with that and this would have been a totally different podcast. but because it was mining crypto in the background, I like started thinking deeper. Okay, what is this stupid thing? worth anything. Like, why? What's the point of mining? What is the actual proof of work doing? And literally two coffees and a beer at Cafe Soleil. I couldn't sleep. And I had this like, and we were talking about like, is it possible to build something like single threaded mining? And I like had this eureka moment that there's a way to encode passage of time as data. And I didn't know what these things were called, but these are called verifiable delay functions. From a high level, we can argue whether the proof of history or the way that Solana's constructed is a true VDF or not, but like it's very similar conceptually, and it's a very rudimentary one. And like these super smart people at Stanford and all over the place have been working on much more sophisticated versions of this, but I couldn't Google for it. Like, it's not like the words verifiable delay function came into my head at 4 a.m. It was the idea that there's a way to encode passage of time. And that's what gave me the instinct that if I have a source of time in the network, in this permissionless network, similar to Bitcoin, then a very hard problem is solved, which is like the way to like synchronize clocks and keep track of time in a permissionless way. And therefore, you can probably get it to work, construct something similar to like time division multiple access, which is what I'm very familiar with, which is what most wireless protocols use is kind of the first way to divide.
So you ended up convincing a bunch of nerds you worked with to give up their careers to go build this thing with you? Is that the way that it worked?
No, like actually, like I was kind of manic and super excited and eventually talked to my wife and she's like, okay, either like for all my life, I've always had a side project. So since that like, whatever, fateful day that I started messing around with Linux in high school and like I've always been like tinkering. So my wife told me that like this isn't like a project that you can just tinker because you gotta actually go full time or like you're not gonna be able to just like build a company on this as a side project. Like the space is too hot and kind of moving too fast. So she kind of like pushed me to quit my job and like actually design and think about like what the company is going to be and like actually like create a product that I could pitch and like go get funding for. And the idea that I had was that like at that time, like I didn't even know that I could even use a VDF to do anything useful in a blockchain. I just had this like instinct. I think I can construct a clock and it'll probably work. And somehow that was like enough. I think it was enough because I was able to get very, very smart people from Qualcomm that I worked with for over a decade and convince them that the most interesting part about all this is that there's now a software platform that devs are going to write code for. And it's a new kind of platform that's just not possible on AWS or anywhere else. That it's a new kind of code that you're writing. It has to be trust minimized, auditable, provable, and reproducible. And that's something very, very new and unique. So that like idea of building an operating system was, I think, what got everyone together. And like what we thought we could focus on was that because of our experience, we could build like the most optimized, fastest version of it. And what I thought was useful out of these systems that like come to Byzantine agreement is that they can guarantee like fairness with regards to how information propagates through this network. And that's very important for finance because I don't know if you ever traded, like when you submit an order, like a bunch of people get to look at your order before it hits an exchange. And when you get to see a quote, a bunch of people have looked at that quote before it got to you. So you're seeing stale information and none of that is very fair, right? So you get to see very kind of delayed reads of what the market is. And when you try to do a write, a lot of people can write in front of you. So both of those problems I thought were solvable by something like that looked like Ethereum, but much, much faster and like optimized to the hilt. So that was kind of the idea that I had. And that's what convinced, I think, a bunch of my colleagues at Qualcomm to join me. And that was pretty lucky because I was able to pull like, you know, like principal engineers, like really, really smart people that have worked on, you know, compilers, GPU architecture, like network protocols, like, you know, the LTE standard, like stuff that like fundamental technologies that like make all cell phones work, and have a lot of experience, like kind of and gut instincts on what's fast and what isn't.
Yeah, that's it's funny, like whenever I'll just want to say it, like when you see online and people like arguing about the knowledge that like some people building Solana have, and like I sort of like laugh in my head sometimes thinking like these guys were building systems on legacy phones that like nobody thought was possible. So like it's really cool to see. How long did it take to build the very first version of the Solana protocol?
So we got, like, we were trying to do it incrementally. So we first proved that we can process that many signatures per second on a single node. And that required 4 GPUs, and we were like targeting 1 million signatures per second. So that was kind of showing that if you have a single node that can do that much, you know, if you have a network of these, it's going to run as fast as the slowest node in that bunch. But if the slowest node is doing 1 million things per second, that's pretty fast. So that was to demonstrate that you don't really need sharding in any other technologies. You just need to demonstrate that you can do that many signatures per second and that you can propagate the data out that quickly. And that took, we actually got something running in 6 months that was single leader, like a bunch of validators that were receiving the data, but like turbine sort of working, but totally busted. And no consensus. It was just single leader. Everyone receives the data and then votes. And we could see that they were doing stuff. And then we had a way to like load C. We could write C code. Like we found a BPF virtual machine, and we got C compiler to generate. And we were actually writing our first smart contracts in C. Just to demonstrate that it works. That took about 6 months, which is pretty fast. But then it took almost 2 years to get consensus and everything else working. Luckily, it was like depth of the bear market, and it wouldn't have mattered if we were delayed or not.
But you guys, I remember this conversation like sort of taking a big risk. You guys really didn't like, weren't super proficient in Rust as far as I know. And this was like a game time decision. You're like, should we do this or shouldn't we? And you just said like, screw it, let's try it in Rust. Or how did that work?
I mean, that was like, Rust was an up and coming language. I think the biggest risk there was that is Rust going to be sticky or not for us to go use it?
It was.
The alternatives were Go or like, even, and Go still, like people weren't sure at the time if Go was going to be sticky or not, or like C++. And just none of us wanted to code in C++ because it felt like work. And like, so I think we picked Rust because it was mostly performant and like closest to like C and like some high performance language. And that worked out. I think you kind of see a lot of blockchains are built in Rust, which is funny, even though, and like a few of them are even programmable in Rust.
I remember like Dan Alpert at Solana Foundation recently was sharing, like when you're talking about doing these tests, and he shared a photo recently of those guys building those bare metal boxes. Like, was that what you were testing on at the time? Or were you guys testing on cloud stuff?
Yeah, we were testing in Google Cloud, but we wanted to test some bare metal because Google Cloud is like, doesn't simulate the real internet as much. And like having bare metal systems, you just have more control. And you could see the difference between like, you can, you know, change the switches up, you can change the mix, things like that.
And how many of those bare metal systems did you guys have whenever you like set that rack up?
I wasn't that much. I think it was like maybe around 20 or something like that. I think at most. It's only later when like the whole foundation delegation program got going that we got access to like, you know, 1,000 boxes.
And this whole, so like that V1, the one, or I guess like before Solana went live on mainnet, how many engineers were actually had worked on that protocol? Like, I mean, I know the original founders and like, 12. I know some, 12? Okay.
Yeah. It's not that many. 12 yeah. engineers for like 2 years. So yeah, 24 months of engineering time. We're able to go from nothing to brand new everything, brand new runtime, brand new consensus mechanism, brand new gossip protocol, block propagation protocol, all that stuff. And like, it definitely like we launched as fast as we could, and we felt that it was safe, that like there weren't any like safety bugs, but liveness bugs were something that like it's just really, really hard to test unless you're out on the open internet and you're interacting with every kind of system that's just like doing the thing that you don't expect. So even though we had like a tour de Sol, which was like a program for validators to join the network and then try to crash it and all this other stuff. And like if we incentivize like malicious behavior in the network, it's really, really hard to like actually test it the way that the real world tests it.
Yeah. So like the experience of like building Solana. So you say you did that in what? In 24 months?
Yep.
And you earlier you mentioned sort of like you were talking mostly about like order books and how that works. And so was your, like, obviously right now there's NFTs, there's gaming, there's social, like when you were actually building this, was your whole mind sort of focused? Like, cause I think the original sort of marketing was like NASDAQ, like on the blockchain essentially. So was that your whole idea that this was going to be a financial system without all this other stuff that lives there on the blockchain now?
Blockchain at NASDAQ speed. We actually like talked to a bunch of different use cases, but I thought that was the hardest use case to get an order book working. And if we could get it to work, it meant that everything else was going to be easy, because like the demands from an order book are really low fees, really fast finality, like confirmation times, and like the high throughput. So if that was our kind of test case and it works, then we probably solved all the other problems. And then we were almost right there. Like the one problem that I missed was that, like how quickly different kinds of use cases and different kind of demands sprung up in the network that just was totally different than you'd expect out of an order book. And that required a different kind of fee model than we initially anticipated.
Yeah, and also like the thing that I didn't realize until like somewhere pretty far into 2021 or early 2022 was just like the complexity of DeFi transactions and like the sort of ramifications of some of that, which is like it's hard to really know that, but like you see like how like the TPS of Solana, which most people call useless metrics, because when you actually factor in like what is happening on a DeFi transaction, it's like pretty incredible. It's not like just like sending a token from Chase to Tolly. It's like there's a lot that goes behind all of that. So moving on a little bit, like it was cool to hear sort of like the whole sort of idea about Solana, but like a lot of the stuff that we like to do on this show is talk about like some things about Solana. And I always ask this question, and I actually asked the question very pointedly, and I know you don't necessarily build on Solana anymore, but like what sucks about Solana development? Like I know you have some opinions on some of this stuff, and they're probably a little more like lower level than some of the engineers building dApps, but like what sucks right now about building on Solana?
I would say that like the lack of interfaces is probably like the biggest pain point. And that's being addressed. There's like a whole project there. And it's a very technical thing. I mean, there's a kind of two pain points. One is a lack of interfaces. The other one is that developers have to specify all the account constraints. The latter one is you can't really get rid of it without incurring like a performance cost. Like, because we force the devs to specify all the dependencies up front, like because the runtime forces devs to do that, like the runtime can then take advantage of that information and schedule everything in parallel and optimize all the prefetches, and that percolates up to the fee markets. You can actually run local fee markets. So all of those things are really important. But
that was your thing for like, that was the trade-off. Make Solana faster by forcing the devs to like rip their hair out.
Yep. It's getting better, because what happens is that one dev rips their hair out, then they write a JavaScript library that does it all for you. And like, to mint a compressed NFT, which is a very, very complex stack, massively complicated stack of things, if you really think of it from end to end, is like two lines of JavaScript at this point.
Yeah.
But this is like kind of something that a lot of people like when they like what I think a lot of people misunderstand about developer experience, it's not about like making everything simple. It's about solving a really, really hard problem that would block a dev like either indefinitely or for 6 months or for like for a very long time, because it requires coordination with many people or something like that to fix. Like, but you really want, like, you can actually give devs problems that they can punch out in a weekend. Like all the stuff that you don't do, like that devs can complete in a weekend, is not actually like, you know, it's okay, right? Like that, those problems are okay to leave to developers. What's really painful to leave for devs are things that they cannot fix. And like one of those things are like expensive fees. If the fees skyrocket, you can't, like a dev, there's nothing a dev can do, right? They're kind of blocked. Same thing with congestion. So like those are like reliability and like those kinds of issues, we gotta fix those.
Well, there's been a lot of work done there. Like, you know, the past like year and a half, 2 years, like there's been some ups and downs. And like, I don't think people realize the undertaking that it was to, number one, like identify that quick and local fee markets were the solution. Like that, it took months for that to even be proposed as an idea. And then like the actual work behind it that made that happen was just like, my brain doesn't comprehend what went on behind that personally. And I think probably that's true for most people who watch this show.
Yeah. This was like a problem that, is obvious in retrospect, but like at the time we kind of assumed that all transactions or a very large number of transactions we're going to see in the network are going to look like serum or like open book transactions, which are like orders in an order book. You have like, they're very fast, they're small, and they don't touch a lot of state. But as soon as you have DeFi, you start seeing people create arbitrage transactions that basically try to touch as much state as possible and maximize the value out of that. So they are submitting these very, very big giant transactions on the network, and those were not properly scheduled or prioritized. And that caused like runtime congestion. That was like one set of problems that we had to fix. So we had to create a compute budget and gas metering and all this stuff. And then the other side of it is like when NFTs took off, you'd have an NFT mint and like literally people spin up like bot farms that would submit 100 gigabit worth of like requests to be first to mint.
So, yes. Like, those are some pretty dark times, to be honest, for most of us around here.
But... we had to fix those problems too. And the cool thing is that like, I don't think we would have had the solution had we not taken this like kind of more painful road. I think the naive solution is to just like globally raise fees, like make the fees go up, and then that causes the spam to back off. But that's very problematic, because that means that if you have a system with DeFi, it cannot support payments at the same time. Those are non-overlapping use cases. And if DeFi causes fees globally to go up, or NFTs cause fees globally to go up, it actually means that you should split the network into three. One that's only does payments, one that only does DeFi, one that only does NFTs.
Otherwise, somebody goes to the grocery store on a huge like DeFi stuff, and they swipe their card, and like they're like, what the hell was that? That cost more than my coffee.
Exactly. So figuring out that that problem existed and that we had a unique solution was like painful process, but I think resulted in like, I think a really awesome product, like at the end of the day. So because we had all of these fixes or all of these things that we added to the runtime to make it parallel, meaning that the devs had all their state dependencies declared ahead of time, you could actually trace this up to where transactions that are added to a block producer. And that block producer can look at all the transactions that are trying to access like a hotspot. Like, this is why this is embarrassing in retrospect. It's a classic database hotspot problem. Like, everyone's trying to access the same hotspot in a database. We can actually prioritize those separately from everything else. And once you do that, you kind of have these very nice isolation for fees, and these local fee markets then can charge access to the state locally, and they don't impact any other fees. So once that was in place, the network like massively stabilized. We start getting these like big DDoS attack vectors, and DeFi liquidations would reliably clear, and like everything's working. So I wish we could have launched with that, like, but sometimes you don't get, you don't have control over that.
Yeah. So the next thing I love to ask is like, so we talked about like what you think is like really like not good stuff about developing on Solana, but like what, like for, in your opinion, like what is great about developing on Solana? It could be a wide spectrum of like your choice. You interpret that however you want. Like, what's great about building on Solana for developers? It could be the tooling. It could be like just anything.
I think you have like now a really good set of tools and like ecosystem companies like Helios and Metaplex and like, you know, Tensor and Magic Eden and like, you know, for whatever kind of thing that you want to build, there's already a very robust, sophisticated API that can get you going and like really cut your development time by, you know, a factor of 10. A lot of the stuff that you need to do has already been written. All you need to do is just kind of manipulate it from the client side with JavaScript. Including even things like governance with like every kind of voting scheme you could imagine. Use compressed NFTs for votes, using regular NFTs for votes, or whatever you want to do. A lot of the stuff basically exists. What we're seeing now are like people then taking these pieces and then like creating new innovative products. So like Vibo is not super systems engineer. He's more like a consumer, like kind of application like developer. The app that he built has minted more NFTs than I think any other app in crypto. It's like over 20 million NFTs. Yeah. Drip House has minted more NFTs than I think every other application combined.
Yeah, it's potentially it's incredible. And yeah, like also now we have Helium with the hotspots, and like there's just like so much cool shit going on. And also, like, even though this might make you cringe, like we do have Seahorse Lang, which you can literally like write Solana programs and it actually works, and that we also are working on some things around the TypeScript version of this. Like, the whole goal here is just to like make this accessible as possible to anybody. And like every day there's like some new abstraction. There's a Unity SDK for Solana. People are building on-chain games now. So to watch, so I've been here for a little over 2 years, to watch the days when I came in and like Discord was, somebody would ask how to like transfer Sol, and the core engineers would just tell somebody to go look at the tests. Gone are those days, because we actually have the resources and like you said, APIs and like Web2 style, yeah, SDKs that do the indexing and like all this stuff for you. Like, it's like there's only a few glass chewers left in this world, like Noah Prince and a handful of these guys that actually are masochists who love actually pain. So they there's still some wild cowboys out there that actually love like just figuring the shit out that nobody else wants to do. So to wrap all this up, man, like there's one final question that I want to ask you. And like, just for all the listeners on this show, it's a lot of younger devs, older devs, but the real question is like, what about that guy who's just thinking about getting into Web3 and building on Solana, or the guy who just started, who's sort of unsure about like what the future looks like. Like, what sort of advice would you give that person who's like really passionate about this, but like not quite there yet?
Like, we've had a ton of companies start out through hackathons, like just go like submit. And even if they don't, even if your project doesn't make it, you can get hired. You can meet like an awesome team and then work on then your next hackathon submission. There's a ton of stories of people that are like, hey, we met during a hackathon and then we continued building and like have now built like Mango Markets or whatever, right? Like, just, it just takes like a bit of perseverance and iteration, but that's what starting any company takes. A lot of it is just blood, sweat, and tears and iteration.
Yeah, and I talk about this a lot. Like, I tell people the ones that grind and stick around eventually find success if they work hard enough. Like, obviously, that's not 100%, but I tell the story sometimes. I met Tensor 2 years ago, and they had no idea what they were building. It was something not Tensor. And then, like, 2 years later, multiple iterations later, like, they didn't just find success overnight. They spent 2 years figuring out what the hell they were going to do, and then, like, they crushed it. And like, here they are basically just really doing an amazing job with their marketplace. Anyways, like, I mean, I think that's good advice. Like, you just like, global hackathons are the big opportunity. Find the right teams, the right people, and just start collaborating and trying to build something fucking cool and just keep at it. Well, thanks, Tolly. Appreciate your time jumping on the show. It was really, I know you're pretty busy guy. I think you're on more podcasts than Joe Rogan at this point in time. So we'll just go ahead and wrap it up. But again, man, thanks a lot. Thanks to everybody for watching, and see you next time.
See ya.